Nuno and João are partners from the Walking Mentorship, and they bring the inside look in the life of the people they walk with. The podcast Keep Walking With Me searches for potential solutions towards the best version of ourselves. Every month, we walk together with a guest. There is a disclaimer that needs to be shared. After listening to this program, you might feel the urge to step outside and go for a long walk. But don't worry, that is absolutely normal. Welcome to the podcast Keep Walking With Me. Today, like always, we have a very special guest walking and talking with us. So let's start asking, in a nutshell, who is Shannon Stowell?
In a nutshell, well, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me to be on the podcast. I listened to an episode just this morning just to refresh myself, and it was really, I love your style and I love the way you pick guests and your thoughtful questions. And so thank you for including me. You know, in a nutshell, I'm a 53-year-old with a couple of kids, and I run an association that has members in 100 countries around the world. I'm an adventurer at heart, but I have to admit, I'm a little more risk averse than I used to be. I love being in nature. I love exploring conversations with people. I can talk until my wife is bored. And I married a Brazilian. So I have a cultural experience every day and mysteries that I don't understand every day. There's my nutshell.
I understand you well. I understand you well, Shannon. I'm married with an Ukrainian lady.
Okay. But you know what? I was thinking about this. This is my second marriage. I was married to an American before. And one thing I love about being married to Gabby from Brazil is that there's an extra layer of mystery because of the cultural differences. And I think that actually adds some, or it can add some magic where you're like, well, why did you think that? Or why would you say that? Or I don't understand that at all. Help me understand. So I think mystery in a relationship is good.
Definitely. Mystery in life is good, actually, I think.
Absolutely.
So, let me look into something a little bit less mysterious, I think. But although it's intriguing, just the same, I mean, you've been the CEO, you are the CEO at ATTA, the Adventure Travel Trade Association, and you,
that's right.
And you have been with the association for 18 years, if I read you right.
That's right.
And on your LinkedIn page, you say that you and your team are all connected by the same ethos and act as one force to save the world through travel. This is really inspiring. But of course, this calls for the question, does the world need saving and from whom? And actually, how can we save it by traveling?
That is a great question. And we kick this concept and this question around all the time. And it's a little bit tongue in cheek, you know, honestly, in the early days, we would raise our hands, our fists in the air and say, adventure travel will save the world, knowing fully well that it will not save the world and it won't solve all the problems, but it's an ideal we hold to try to make our part of the world better as best we can, as best we can understand it through the actions and the decisions and the policies. And so really what we're focused on is trying to make tourism more responsible and healthier. That's really the more down to earth explanation of what our mission is. We really focus on trying to develop and promote travel that is protecting culture and nature. That's really what it boils down to. And those are obviously very broad concepts. Like culture, for us, one of our passions is making sure the local people, especially when they're indigenous people, mm-hmm. are involved in the process of tourism, that they're not mm-hmm. a sideshow, but they're yeah. actually part of the process of making decisions of who comes to their place and how those people experience it. And so, for example, one of the philosophies we've been putting out there since 2018 when we did our summit in Tuscany is travel is a privilege. It's not a right. And I think that there's too many travelers that believe it's their right to travel. And when you carry that attitude, it can be weighted down with the baggage of entitlement, mm-hmm. of a moral or an ethical vacation, as in, I'm here spending my money. I can do what I want. Yeah, I can go where I want. I can take what I want. And we firmly reject that philosophy. And I want to have the attitude as if either of you gentlemen invited me to your home and your neighborhood, I want to be your guest. I want to honor your traditions. Mm-hmm. I want to be respectful of what you are appreciating, what's important to you, and not to violate that. So my sense is tourism, especially pre-pandemic, with all the over-tourism, there was so much exploitation and destruction in the world caused by tourism. So our goal really is to do whatever we can to change that.
Oh,
and that's a lot, actually.
That's a lot.
I think it's what you touched. It's really impactful. And of course, it might not be the only thing that saves the world, but certainly it goes one step in the right direction. And that probably is as much as we can expect.
Exactly. We often use the term, let's move the needle. You know, if we can move the needle to the left a little bit and just get things a little better than when we left it, then that is a success.
Well, so... indeed. And actually, Shannon, you just kind of define, or you frame the term, and let me pick on that and
sure.
and
sure.
ask you, I mean, adventure travel. I mean, what is this about? Because is it when I, you know, jump off a cliff on a bungee jumping, or I run a marathon in the Amazons, or it is a deep dive into my purpose in life? I mean, how could you define adventure travel today?
It's such a smart question. And it's a question that I have been asked since day one. And it's never fully resolved in people's minds. And it is funny because I was in a group of journalists once on a trip, and somebody saw my name tag, Adventure Travel Trade Association, and he looked at me and smirked and said, "Oh, hello, Captain Zipline." And that's how the conversation started. But so we set out to try to define this years ago, and because in the early days, people said travel was either adventure travel or not adventure travel. Hmm. And then they try to define it as hard, soft, or not. And that definition still leaves you really wanting. And so we did a lot of studies with travelers and found that there were three themes emerging. That if a trip involved immersion in nature, mm-hmm. involvement with the culture, the local culture, and some sort of physical activity, then that was kind of the core of adventure travel. And so activity, nature, culture-based trips are at the heart. And what I love about that loose definition is the grandmother who wants to walk on the trail in Portugal is an adventure traveler.
Yeah.
The guy who is running the marathon in the Amazon from the UK, he's also an adventure traveler. Since then, we've actually even gone further and said, okay, so it's interesting to know what the three pillars are, but what are the motivations? And then we studied that. So we're getting a more and more nuanced definition and understanding. And now we're understanding some of the things that drive people to do it, which is personal transformation, health and wellness, spirituality. What kind of impact am I having on this place? And so we've come a long way in 18 years from, is this adventure travel or not adventure travel when we look at a trip?
That's great.
That's an adventure. Huh?
Yes.
And again, we are moving the needle again. Thank you.
That's right. That's right. So the last thing I would say, and then I'll wrap that up, but we really believe adventure travel is very accessible, and a lot of people do immediately assume that it's extreme and risk driven, but it's really not. It comes down to nature, culture, and activity.
Yeah.
Well, I love that definition, and actually it totally fits what we do at Walking Mentorship, because definitely we do activity as we do always walking the path.
That's what that attracted me.
Yeah.
I loved it.
And we definitely go into nature as much as possible, and we go into the culture. So we actually look at luxury as being real, being authentic and respectful of the local traditions and people. And you can have amazing experiences with very simple things. And that really is the adventure, I would say.
That's right.
And it's really inspiring to hear you say that. So, well, let me pick up on that and really, with all the many, many people you have touched, and many cultures for sure, and many adventures, is there a particular lesson that you learned in life and that you would like to share with us?
I think it would be, don't assume anything, and don't assume you know best. You know, I so many times when we're traveling, we see a situation and we think we might know best. I'll give a real brief example, and that in many cases is orphanage tourism in Southeast Asia. The tourist comes and sees these orphans, their heart breaks appropriately, and they're motivated correctly, and they give. What they don't know is some of the figures say up to 80% of those kids do have parents. Many are being exploited, and many are not in school because they're being given money by unwitting tourists who have the right motivation in mind. So and I could give you 100 examples, but I don't want to use up all our time. But I think, you know, another one was a local culture that the tourists were told by the tour guide to bring toothbrushes and toothpaste because these kids didn't have it. And a wise lady in the village said, don't bring us your toothbrushes and toothpaste because you're never going to bring us more toothpaste. And then what do these kids do? And we actually have methods here. We have old methods for taking care of our teeth, and this takes it away. And so, again, hundreds and hundreds of examples. But so I really try to stop myself when I see a situation or I hear something said. I'm like, I am so unaware of all the things surrounding the issues here. I really need to just be quiet and listen and try to learn. And hopefully I'm with a local guide who's a really good guide who understands what's going on and can be not only my physical guide to drive me and walk me, but also to guide me mentally and emotionally on that trip to say, you know, here's the reality of what's going on here. They don't need your help.
Yeah. Well, but that's a great way to take us to the next challenge, because, you know, music can really guide us as well, not only in terms of emotions, but actually in terms of so many other things that we cannot express in other ways rather than music. So maybe it's a good time, Shannon, for you to give us your first song.
Yes, I would say Whatever Makes You Smile by John Van Dusen.
So let's listen to John Van Dusen.
I'm devil's meat. Oh, be here when I wake up.
Thank you so much, Shannon. That was great to listen. Really inspiring. And let's get back to our conversation. As we know, we walk, and we think walks can be the most extraordinary experiences in life. Is there a particular walk that shaped your life or marked it in some way that you would share with us?
Yes, and also I want to correct, I got the name wrong because of the song. It's Whatever Makes You Mine, but one of the lines is Whatever Makes You Smile. So
okay.
Yeah. Yeah,
I think it can work.
Just to correct that.
Perfect.
I do need my second cup of coffee this morning. So I could pick all sorts of epic walks, but I'm just going to pick a place that I walk a lot with my wife and with the dogs. And it's here in Colorado in Browns Canyon National Monument, which was created under the Obama administration. And it's a very small area, 33 square miles, has the Arkansas River bordering it. And it's some of the wildest, most accessible country that I know. And we walk in it all the time. That's like our, one of our number one goals every week is how do we get up there and spend time walking. And the reason I love it is I've never run across another person in the last year and a half of intensive walking and hiking in there, not one time. And we've seen elk and deer and eagles and hawks and fox and coyote and bobcat. And it's just quiet. It's just silent, unless it's windy. I guess I will say there was one particular time we chose a route we didn't know, and a blizzard came in, and it was amazing because we weren't afraid, because we knew where we were and we knew how to navigate out, because we walked the area so much. And although this particular route was unusual, that day was just magical. And we got back to the main road and we did run into somebody there, which we were shocked by because nobody's ever back there. But on this main road, here's this young couple. And so they caught up to us because they were faster than us. We struck up a conversation and a friendship, and they ended up coming and visiting us at our cabin. We had a warm cobbler and a nice beer, and then we gave them a ride to their car. And so it was just this kind of magical nature plus new human friendship moment.
that's so wonderful, Shannon, because actually that takes us to talk about time. We know that we actually believe that the ultimate luxury of our lives is time. And we often are told that our programs are very inefficient because we usually take about the full week to walk back what usually you do with a 30-minute train ride. But we do that, obviously, deliberately to actually help us to take the time to allow for a better thinking. So my question for you is, what are your thoughts on time? What do you think?
I think about it a lot. I'm 53, so I'm not young. I'm also not old. I'm in that space where I'm aware that time is slipping away. And, you know, just to be personal for a moment, I had a near-death experience in 2014. And basically, I had a defective heart valve and I didn't know it. And I came very close to dying. And it was actually kind of miraculous that they even discovered it. I had to go into emergency surgery and they, of course, saved me, obviously, since we're talking here. And after that, after I came out of that, and it took me about 4 months to recover, I just looked at time as my number one, the thing that I value. I value my relationships the most, but part of that is because I want time. I want time with people. I want time to ponder the mysteries of God and the universe. I want time to spend with my family doing fun things and just hanging out. I had a very quiet dinner with my mom the other night and we just spent some time and it was lovely.
Wonderful.
So time is incredibly precious to me. And it's one of the things that makes me anxious, because in my role, there is a lot of pressure. There is a lot of, the work is never ending. Like most people today, I could work forever every day and never sleep. So I really have to make decisions and just say, is this worth spending time on? And I don't always get it right. In fact, I get it wrong a lot. And then later on retrospect, I think I should have rethought that. I have started making a lot of my meetings 15 minutes to 30 minutes instead of just defaulting to an hour.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just because so many business meetings don't need to be an hour long.
No.
So I think about it a lot, to be honest.
It's so great, your answer. Shannon, I have to share with you that I think it was about 3 years ago, I promised to myself that every single meeting that I didn't need to manipulate documents. I would do it walking. And I've been doing that since that moment. And the impact is just absolutely incredible. First of all, because
yes.
I love to walk. Second, because some meetings, the only way for you to survive them actually is to be out and walking.
I agree.
You will die. But on the other side, I'm also doing things that are really good for myself. I mean, I'm moving, and people are actually, now it's exactly the other way around. If people catch me in front of a screen at home, they ask me if I'm okay. That's interesting. You know, are you sick? No, I just happen to be here. And the other thing is that I guess I was born with half of my brain on my feet. So actually, if I massage my brain and I walk, I think better. And
I love it.
It resonates so much what you just said about using time as this actually really ultimate luxury in your life. And that obviously defines better the criteria to do certain things and to stop doing others. I mean, it's quite obvious, but I'm very glad they fixed that thing in your heart and you are here talking with us.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I actually did a lot of my meetings walking last year. I was actually hiking, and there was one day I was just hiking, looking at the ground, talking to a guy about a conference. And all of a sudden, right in front of me was a Native American arrowhead laying right on the ground in front of me.
Amazing.
Probably 1,000 years old.
Wow.
And I just kept the meeting going. I didn't tell him. I just went, wow, inside. Yeah. So I love walking and meeting too. Only when the wind is bad, it makes it difficult.
That's true.
You need to look for a shelter place.
Yes.
Well, but thank you so much for sharing that very personal experience, but definitely it connects to the idea that time is in fact the most precious thing probably we all have, and it's also the most democratic. I mean, it's more or less the same for everybody.
That's right.
Buy it.
can I say one funny thing
go
about
ahead.
This?
Yeah, sure.
So we do an Adventure Travel World Summit every year, and in 2012 we were in Switzerland for it, and in 2013 it was going to be in Namibia. And at the end of the 2012 summit, we always have this tradition of the summit host gives a gift to the next year's summit host.
Yeah.
and the Swiss gave the Namibians a Swiss clock, and without missing a beat, the Namibian said, "You Swiss have the gift of clocks, but we have the gift of time." Well, and the Swiss were very good natured about it. I heard him tell that story just this last year. It was a lovely moment.
And because it's beautiful. I mean, it's really beautiful, and it's so humbling, actually. You know, it's just like that in the end. Well, but talking about time, and we've been going through strange times lately, but I mean, things will move forward, and hopefully we will all be safer and in good conditions to resume a normal life, hopefully better life. And in that sense, you already mentioned over tourism, but do you fear that with going back to normal, over tourism will become a problem again? And if so, what can we do right now or in the near future to improve that situation, to move the needle a little bit?
Yeah, you know, it's a vexing question and problem, because part of me thinks that it won't be as bad, at least for a while, because, you know, there's lots of predictions that business travel, which contributes to some degree, is not going to come back like it did. And the reason is so many people figured out that maybe that flight from San Francisco to New York for one meeting, that didn't make any sense.
No, it's just crazy.
So those are going away. So on one level, it's going to slow some travel down. On the other hand, my fear is that many of the mass tourism systems are built on, have legacy challenges. If you have a room that has three, or a hotel that has 3,000 rooms, you might have the best intentions in the world to attack over tourism, but you need to fill those rooms. Mm-hmm. You're not motivated to slow it down. So my hope is that the traveler starts to change. And I think there's some signs that there is some. The fact that there's more interest in sustainability during and after, or during, we're still during the pandemic, is counterintuitive. The CEO of BlackRock, the world's largest asset holder, multi-trillions of dollars, said that publicly. So this wasn't Greenpeace saying it. It wasn't us saying it. It was the biggest money manager in the world said, counterintuitively, people seem to care more about sustainability versus less. So I find that encouraging, and I really hope that the traveler drives the change. And, you know, in the community I work and live in the adventure travel community, we our community has always been about small groups, going to remote locations, you know, staying small, basically. Even the big adventure travel companies are still sending out small groups and avoiding the big crowded places. So it's not, the space I work in doesn't need to do a huge shift, but I think if we can convince more travelers that they'll actually have a better experience if they go to Jordan and take a small tour with a Bedouin in Wadi Rum, you know, versus getting on a bus with 60 other people and hopping off, taking a picture, hopping back on, listening to somebody yelling through a bullhorn, you know, on how special and spiritual this site is through a bullhorn, you know, can we rethink what a good trip is? And I realize, you know, that might be a little oversimplistic. It's more expensive. It's harder to do. It's harder to find. So I understand there's challenges, but yes, in a nutshell, I am worried that certain places will snap right back to over tourism as quickly as they possibly can, because they kind of have to. And, you know, cruise is an example. What are they going to do? Just park those cruise ships? My understanding is a lot of them are cruising around right now empty because they, you know, I don't know all the details. They can't even really just go park them and let them sit somewhere because they start to decay, fall apart. So I'm absolutely concerned, but I think a lot of people hopefully have learned some lessons. So I think it's, you know, it's going to take everybody, media, travelers, businesses, governments, NGOs. And we're working, like we did a project with Peru before the pandemic, and we helped take buyers and media to Peru. And we worked together with the government, and they said, we really don't want more people going to Machu Picchu. There's enough. It sells itself. And so we took these buyers and media on trips around Peru, and no one ever went to Machu Picchu. And so to me, that's a strategy to say Peru's an incredible country with or without Machu Picchu.
Exactly. Well, Shannon, this is, it is actually this exercise of looking at the world today. I mean, that's what we are doing here. And I would like to ask you, I mean, you just mentioned before that you have a lot on your plate. So in what are you planning to focus your energy in the near future? I mean, or in another words, where do you want to move the needle? Where do you want to place that energy?
Well, our community has been hit particularly hard because they're mostly focused on international travel. And in 2021, the numbers are in now. It was 72% down still over 2019. So that's not even talking about the devastation of 2020. So our community is in serious recovery mode. So everything that we're doing right now is focused on trying to bring resources to our community. We even tried to find funding for emergency relief. so far we haven't been successful in doing that because everybody's looking for money. We put a lot of free resources together. We reached out and got everyone who would pitch in, even a friend of mine who runs an accounting firm. Actually, it's that he runs a firm that employs CFOs. They gave of their time for free to any of our members who needed help understanding their finances. So we really have been focused on supporting and helping our community recover. And parts of it are starting to show signs. So I'm flying to Panama in 2 weeks to put on our first international in-person event for adventure travel professionals. So this is part of the recovery, is that we're getting back together and we're doing it safely. You have to be vaccinated. We'll be using masks and distancing, and everybody knows the rules. And we just did one in Arizona here in the US, and it was a real success because our community desperately needs to get back together to tell their stories, to buy and sell tourism experiences to each other. So that's what I'm focused on, is that's what we are focused on, is really just helping our community recover. And we also decided, even through the difficulties, not to relax on our climate efforts. So we launched Tomorrow's Air during the pandemic, which is actually available to travelers, and it allows travelers to pay for recapture of carbon, not carbon offset, but actual recapture, a permanent solution. So that's another focus for us, is continuing to try to make a dent on climate, because I know that there's a section of society in the world that's doing the flight shaming and people shouldn't travel. You know, it's just not the reality. People are going to travel. Some won't. That's fine. That's their choice. But the reality is a lot are. So we're trying to create tools for those who are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Definitely there are approaches that can be very impactful without going, to the extreme and actually telling people they cannot travel, because, as you say, it's not even can't even be done. I mean, and hopefully it cannot be done, because I don't think it would be good. It would be much better to look for the alternative ways, and there are many, and you already mentioned
absolutely that. Well, and the communities, the small communities on the other end, they're in dire need of travelers to show up for food,
absolutely,
for basic needs. So so it's a complicated situation.
You need to look at the whole perspective, the global perspective, and not just focus on one side, of course, as it might be. Well, but let's lighten up the mood a little bit. Do you want to share with us the your second music?
Sure. I'll go with Blindside, Where the Sun Never Dies. And it's not a super light song, but for me, I grew up in a really conservative environment. And so I gravitated to harder rock and harder music. And and yet I didn't like destructive or vulgar bands and lyrics. It just didn't work for me. And Blindside is a Swedish band, a band that started sometime, I think, in the late 80s. And I just love their music. And this song's kind of thinking about after we're gone, and talks about basically the beyond. And I love how they do it, because they acknowledge that we have our own challenges, our shadows, but someday those will be shown away in the end. So,
wow.
That's the song. This is the song I just really love. I've loved for many, many years.
Well, cool. Let's meet where the sun never dies.
Still calling, but I'm still calling. Where the sun never
Wow, Shannon, thank you. Wow. We need time to digest. Maybe we need to listen again. And while we are doing that, well, let's kick off our series of unfair questions. That's okay. The way we like to call it.
I love it.
So the first one is, can you share with us a moment where you experienced awe?
Yes. I had to think about that a second. So this is probably 20 years ago, and I've had other awe-filled moments, but this one just, I mean, it immediately popped in my head when you asked this question. So I was winter camping not far from here, actually, with my brother, and it was bitterly cold, and we were up in the mountains, and we were just going to go and spend one night in a place called the Three Apostles Wilderness. And I had not winter camped like this before. I'd done a little bit, but so we ended up in this tent in this valley in deep snow. We snowshoed in, we set up our tent, went to bed. It was bitterly cold. And at about 2 a.m, I had to go to the bathroom, and I got out of the tent. And at first I was grumpy, right? Because it's absolutely frigid. And then I stepped out and the moon was way behind this mountain in a way that made the sky a purple you could barely see. So the moon wasn't bright. It was hidden completely, and it was far beyond the mountain, but it was so faint. You know, when you look directly at something and you almost can't see it, and then you look to the side and then you can see it from your peripheral vision.
Yeah.
It was one of those moments where when I looked just to the side of the mountain, I could see the shape of the mountain in this deep purple. And that moment, I just stood there and froze. It was incredible. I didn't care anymore. It was like, I wanted to shake my brother and wake him up and say, "You got to see this." But I knew that it was a moment just for me.
Yeah,
not for Ryan.
You would spoil it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And well, ruin his sleep.
Yes.
Well, amazing. You took us there right now.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Well, let's follow up with another one, which is, quite a challenging question. But we have this belief that no matter the circumstances of your life, the constraints of your life, you always have the opportunity to make a masterpiece out of it. Mm-hmm. So what is your opinion on this? How can we make masterpieces out of our lives?
I think to try not to say something trite, you know, I think that one observation I have is there are a lot of people. In fact, I met a guy in Panama recently. He was a doctor from Guatemala, and we were at a rum tasting, and he said the saddest thing. He's a doctor, and he asked what we do, and we told him that we work in adventure travel. And he said, "I wish I would have done something like that, but now I have to be a doctor." The pressure was on. I did it. I make a great living. You could tell it was just heartbreaking. I think that there are signals for us from an early age, from the earliest of age, what we're good at and what brings us alive.
Yes, there are.
And sometimes it takes going to your friends, your family who really care for you, who don't have an agenda, who say, "You know what you were really good at? You're so good with kids. You were always good with kids, or you always had a really tender heart." And I encourage people to think about those and find a way to maximize those things. And I had a conversation with a friend who was offered an incredible job, and he bombed it. He bombed it so hard. And he took the job because it was an incredible job, but it didn't fit what he was personally built to do, his personal skills and joys and strengths. And the conversation we had is, for the first part of your life, you should say yes to almost everything and try you know, within bounds, obviously, not insane things, but, you know, try things, try jobs, try volunteering, try reading, try eating things. Yes, 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 yes. Once you kind of have a sense of what you're really, truly good at and what makes you alive and then what kills your heart, start to know. So I know it's not that simple, but I almost envision it as a point for me when I hit like somewhere in my 30s and 40s and it's like, no, no, nope, no, 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 no. My dogs are looking back at me like, what did I do? So I think it goes so far beyond profession, right? It's what are you remarkable about? What makes you special in the world? And then how do you amplify that? And how do you try to crank down on anything that's against that? And that's very vague, but I know we don't have a lot of time. I hope that resonates for somebody. For me, it was about really realizing that I relate well to people and I love working and talking with people and I hate details. I'm horrible with details. And so I've tried to structure my life so that other people who like doing details, they do those details because I'm terrible at it. I mess them up anyway. And I try to focus on people.
Well,
Shannon, that's not vague. I think it's a great answer. Well, I think, sorry, Joan, to jump in, but I know Shannon is already a little bit tired of time. So maybe we jump on for our third music.
So the last song is We'll Meet Again. And it was written in 1939. And the name of the lady who wrote it is escaping me. Dame Vera. Anyway, but Johnny Cash covers it. And, oh, man, I get teary every time I hear it. And for me, I think about my dad because I lost my dad a couple years ago. And so this song is just about the next chapter, the chapter after the one where our feet are on the ground here on planet Earth. And so I just love this song. I think it's haunting and beautiful and sad and wonderful all at once.
It is a wonderful song. Let's listen to it.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them that I won't be long, and they'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Yeah, we'll meet again. I don't know where, and I don't know when, but I do know that we'll meet again some sunny day. So honey, keep on smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And would you please say hello to all the folks that I know, and tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Well, Shannon, it is indeed a wonderful song. And just to finalize our Walkcast, I think we cannot call this a podcast because, honestly speaking, this is a Walkcast. I don't know if the word exists, but
I love it.
It sounds right. When I listen to this version of Johnny Cash, I have the impression that when you reach a certain time in your life, and I'm thinking about Johnny Cash in his last years. I'm thinking about Leonard Cohen in his last years. This is like, I think they're already touching something that the majority of people are not there yet. So it is something deeply spiritual, actually.
Absolutely.
It's absolutely wonderful. But we have a classic question to finalize our Walkcast, but I will leave that to Nuno. But I do have one question for you, because I know that you spent some years in Seattle, so Washington State. So I guess that you are very familiar with nature elements like rain, for instance.
Yeah, I sure am.
But let me ask you, Can you identify a great lesson you learn from nature? I mean, something that you really understood. This was a lesson made for me from Mother Nature, and thank you very much, even if it was a hard one.
Yeah. Oh, that's an easy one. Last winter, I made a bad decision to drive a road in the winter that I should have known better, but I thought I could get through because I do have a good four-wheel drive, and my wife and dog were with me. And we were driving on this back road where nobody is. And we were trying to get to our cabin, to home. We lived off grid for 9 months, and we were trying to get there a back route to shortcut a little bit. And the snow was about 2 inches deep on the road, a dirt road. And then it was 3 inches deep, then 4 inches deep, then back to two. And I thought, okay, we're good. We're good. And I came over this hill and all of a sudden, poof, and it was three feet deep of snow. And we were impossibly stuck. I had an avalanche shovel with me. So I dug furiously under the car for an hour, and the sun was starting to go down. And we were far from civilization, and there was no cell phone coverage. And I got all the wheels cleared, started the car, and they all spun because we were on a pillar of ice. The heat of the car had compressed that deep snow into a pillar of ice, and we were impossibly stuck. There were no trees to use a winch on. We were in trouble. So we started hiking out, and it started getting dark, and it was going to be incredibly cold. And we were underprepared. And we managed to get up on a mountainside and got just one bar and made a call to emergency services and then lost the call.
Oh,
but what they told us, I thought we were 10 miles in, we were 24 miles away from civilization. So we were facing an incredibly difficult and dangerous night. And for me, the lesson was nature's the boss. Nature's the boss. And the way the story ended is happy, thankfully. The emergency signal was on long enough that a tow truck equipped for that kind of environment came out and found us and got us out in the dark. And we were able to get home that night. But it was a super humbling experience of how powerful and strong, and in that case, totally silent nature was. Nature's the boss.
I know that we are not going to go down this road, but looking at the current situation in the world, it also actually takes me exactly in that direction. Nature is the boss.
Is always the boss.
I agree.
Always.
Very humbling. Very humbling. Nunu, I pass it to you.
Well, so let me give you, I love this question, and I hope you will enjoy it too. It's very simple, actually. It's just like this. If you had a time capsule where you could place anything or any message or any object, whatever, it's whatever the size you want to make it, and you put a message inside or you put something inside and you shoot it off into the universe or just a bottle in the sea, whatever, and someone or something will find it tomorrow or 1,000 years from now or whenever, what would you put inside that time capsule?
Love is all you need.
That was quick and beautiful.
You know, I guess I would add, but seek truth, not your own truth, but truth, the bigger truth with the big T.
Maybe that's the same.
And
huh?
Maybe it's the same. Maybe it's the same. Wow, that's a question I did not see coming. That was the curveball. The others, I could kind of field pretty quickly and easily. That one's going to make me think for a while today. Thank you.
Well, but it's your answer is beautiful. I love it.
Absolutely. Really.
And it came from the heart. So, well, Shannon, thank you so much for this wonderful walk. It's been beautiful. You've been very generous with us and shared so much. We are immensely grateful and really hope to walk with you soon.
Absolutely. Shannon, and
well,
thank
now
you.
I have a new goal, which is to walk in person with you two.
Sure. Oh. We would love that. And we'll need to make that. It possible.
we like our Walkcasts, but we prefer the real thing, you know?
Absolutely.
Always better.
Absolutely. A glass of wine at the end of the day.
Sure. Sounds
well,
lovely.
We look forward for that, Shannon. And a big thank you for your generosity in everything you're doing. And we send you from the other side of the pond, you know, as much energy as you need to continue on your journey, on your mission, you know, moving the needle, because little by little, by moving the needle, we'll take the world to a much brighter place than we are today. And we all share that. So it is really an honor and a pleasure to walk with you.
Thank you, gentlemen. I really am honored. It was a blast talking to you. The fact that we laughed a lot says a lot. And I look forward to our in-person meeting someday.
Sure.
Looking forward, Shannon. Looking forward. Thank you.
Let's
take care.
Bye-bye.
Keep Walking With Me. It is a podcast inspired by the Walking Mentorship experience. Step by step, we walk together towards the best version of ourselves. For more information about our mentoring programs, visit our website, walkingmentorship.com.